I'm not here to introduce James Brown, but I am, in a way, here to make a kind of, I think there's a sort of memorial lecture aspect to this evening, because Tom Sachs was a student here 10 years ago, and some students pester, and I wasn't teaching here, and he pestered me a lot. And eventually, it's easier to meet people who pester, because then they stop pestering. So we met. And Tom reminded me at the weekend that we haven't actually met for 10 years, which is quite extraordinary, because I've lost most of my hair in that time, and he's doubled his quantity. So the memorial is really to staying in touch, which has probably been a scruffy postcard once every 18 months. But there are just those few relationships that can function on that, and this seems to be one of them. On Saturday night, I was in, I would say, fairly elegant Parisian commercial art gallery, and I witnessed a full-size guillotine, made as if it were made by a backwoodsman, bearing the logo of Chanel on all faces, actually function. And I don't know whether any of you have ever witnessed a guillotine function, but with Chanel or not, it's very, very disturbing. This was Tom's work in Paris. If you happen to be on the Eurostar in the next month, you can see his show. And always remember that slides are just pictures and the show is different. And in the beginning of April, this show comes to Camden, which it says somewhere in it, it may not be my fault, but it is my responsibility. And Tom has actually brought with him the exhibit that he's going to show in the show, and he's going to, I think, explain it to you later.
Do you want it? Do you want it?
Is this your moment to show it?
Maybe, we'll wait, yeah.
So it's with great pleasure to meet Tom after 10 years and see what he's been up to. Thank you, Tom.
Really nice, man. Hi. Oh, I don't need this. That's right. So can we turn the music up a little bit just so you can hear the beat? Okay, I'm still louder than James, right? Okay. So this seems loud. It seems too loud. So this is I'm too loud still. This is a model of the Chanel chainsaw, and it's a model of my steel 066 Magnum chainsaw. It's the chainsaw that I use. And it's full scale. It's like the baddest chainsaw. I'm really not big enough or strong enough to handle it, but it's the baddest chainsaw you can get. It's like made in Germany and everything. It's really good. But this is a hot glue gun model made of Chanel packaging, and everything that you see here is probably made, unless otherwise noted, is what it is, or else it's made with hot glue gun. And it's got every screw represented crudely, but it's all there. And this is my toilet from my studio, and it's with Prada packaging, and it flushes, I mean, sort of without the water. You could probably use it once. I mean, it's got all the internal workings, and it moves around. And it's all one-to-one. Yeah. This is called Hermes Value Meal Number 4, and the title comes from the Canal Street McDonald's, which is the closest one to my studio in New York, and it's like the value meal. So you get a Big Mac, a large Coke, and a large fries, and it's this kind of a special price, so in the tray, but it's in Hermes. So these things aren't really like advertising quality models. They're much rougher in real life. They look slick because of the good lighting. And then this is sort of a detail of the French fries container, but I guess what's the reason why I'm showing it here is because in New York, like, we pick up our dog shit, and in France, I noticed they don't. They have these cool BMWs with these like tubes going over the top with soapy water that swirls around the shit and it gets sucked back. And it's like an interesting way to give the dog shit picker up or guy like some masculinity and like a good fun toy to play with while he's doing this. But in New York, if you're walking your dog and you see one of these, you're psyched because it's the ultimate, like, it just scrapes it all up in one loaf and just like in the trash, you're done, clean, boom. But that's more about our conversation, Richard. And so again, this is value meal number 3. It's chicken McNuggets, extra size at fries, it's bigger than large, large Coke, and then the sauce. And it's every French fry sort of poured out on the table, then measured and made model of, sort of.
Sort of or really? Sort of or really?
Well, it is really. Like, we do every one, but in the end, when you do that, you wind up with something that doesn't really look like it, and you shove it back in and try and make it work. It's like if you use a template made from the next piece and you keep going one generation next, you get like this grainy reproduction that it's a dub version, and we're talking about dub music before, where everyone know what dub music is. It's like this thing, like you take a hit song and you remove the vocal track and you bring up the bass and the drums and you add a synthesizer track so you can hear that it's the original song, but it's a little bit more lysergic and ethereal sometimes, and without the vocal track, it was designed so that reggae sort of MCs or toasters, as they're called, can sing over it and do their own vocals. But the effect is a different version. I think that's what it is. It's a different version. So it starts with every same fry, but it ends up being a little bit different.
And when you say we, are there lots of people making these fries?
Oh, we're trying to increase the amount of production at Allied Cultural Prosthetics, and this European public relations tour is hopefully going to be helpful in realizing those goals.
So. Well, we'll come back to the factory.
And by the way, that reminds me the disclaimer that these ideas before you do not necessarily represent those by the Architectural Association. And I meant to say that at the beginning, I forgot. This is a Tiffany's Glock, because if you go to the Arms and Armory Department at the Met in New York, you'll see there's a collection of arms, and only two of them are in the 20th century, and those are Smith & Wesson guns that were made by Tiffany's with silver handles and turquoise inlays and stuff like that. So this is a Glock, which is like the Air Jordan of guns. It's the gun that I use in New York, and it's, you know, it's like the industry standard. It's cheap. It's like $500. You know, packed 17. It's compact.
And the cardboard ones don't work.
No, these don't work. But like the chainsaw, it doesn't really cut wood. But it's got every screw and every part and most of the internal parts too. This is called Mr. President. It's a model of a Mannlicher Carcano. Which is allegedly used to shoot President Kennedy in the head 3 times or something. And by the way, I'm not like a conspiracy freak, but I had to buy this gun to make a model of it, and it's like the biggest piece of shit you've ever seen. There's no way you could do 3 bolt actions and aim and shoot from across 3 blocks or whatever it was. So definitely a conspiracy. And it's an Italian war surplus. And again, this is the vice in the studio. It's the Charles Parker Machine Company. So it's called Bird Flight, Gucci is a vice because it's made from Gucci packaging. Which is also kind of like a casino segue you know, casino where they put the guy's head in the vice. There's like some fashions in that. Fountain, obvious, a little heavy-handed, but it's paper, it's not ceramic, and those are the hot glue gun marks.
I've seen that in the flesh, and it's quite, I think the best thing about it is that it's pathetic.
Thanks.
I mean, when you press it, you know, you press it and it gives.
Yeah, it's like it's stuffed with plastic bags, and it was the only way to make it work. And but at the same time, it looks like ceramic. It looks like it could kill you. But it's kind of sad, mopey.
Well, that's what pathetic means in English.
Oh, okay. Next to X. I'm not going to comment about that, but I could, and maybe we'll get to it. We'll talk about England pretty soon. This is called Spousal Abuse Kit. It's inside, it's foam core box, and it was kind of, this is a little dated because it was kind of during OJ, you know, there was the glove and the left-handed golf club and the golf ball, which is kind of more from Pulp Fiction than from OJ itself, and then the tape and everything. But the handle and the lashes are made of Velcro and gaffer's tape. Duct tape's kind of like an American version of gaffer's tape. It's a vinyl tape instead of polypropylene. It's polypropylene instead of vinyl, so it's cheaper but more waterproof. And it's endless 9X, and it's dialing instructions from payphones on a steel base. It's about a meter high. Endless call waiting. This is really dated, even though it's only like 3 years old because of the size of the phone. Remember when those were the phone, the big ones? And that's because Barney's is a store in Manhattan that owes me a lot of money. So I, from window display stuff, and I was always on the phone, so that's why it's waiting and waiting. And this is Prada Death Camp. It's kind of a composite death camp. It's like Auschwitz and Birkenau. It's, you know, it's got crematorium 4, and it's got the gate of death and the train and the barracks and Canada, where all the stolen stuff is kept. And it's kind of like a pop-up composite death camp, in that the sides fold up and there's a lid that goes on top, which you can't see here, but you can imagine instead of this Swiss cross, it was like popped up in a book. And it's thread holding it.
Has it been sold?
Yeah, actually this really interesting guy bought it, and he asked me if he was living in Paris, but he asked if I wouldn't mind if he brought it to Berlin where he lives, so he could show it in Berlin. And I was like, oh my god, you have to ask me? I was so pleased that it's going to Berlin. It's the ultimate. It's like ground zero. You
know? Is it a maquette for a full scale? I mean, there's a thing about the size of all these things. Some of them are true to scale.
Everything that you've seen is full scale. This obviously isn't, and nor is it the exact layout. I took some liberty here just because I really think it's important for art to look good. Like, we're talking about pathetic, and there's this whole movement in America right now where, like, all the, you go to art galleries and it all looks like shit. And you're like, I mean, I think it's really important for the stuff, whatever it is, to look good so that it looks good. It's art, you know. I mean, I've had some problems with the idea of art, and like, to me, this is more arts and crafts, but, or hobbying or something, I don't know. But it should always look good, because that way it's accessible to people. It's like the drums are the most important part of a pop song. And the great ones, the ones that last the test of time, have a good rhythm section. It's like, it has to, you've got to work to make it accessible. So that's why it doesn't look exactly like Auschwitz 2, and that's why it looks like something that's more organized. But if you can think that there's anything
in the present circumstances, it's quite likely that someone will invite you to make a full-size one.
Okay, man, let's make a deal. I mean, that would be very interesting. I think it would be a great thing to do that. But not in Prada.
Do Prada know about this?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, they gave me the packages. They're really helpful. In fact, the question... Okay, I'm just going to get all the dumb questions out of the way. No one sued me. I don't get in trouble. I don't ask for permission, because it's easier to beg for forgiveness than ask for permission. And Luis in the box room at Prada hooks me up. He like saves the ones I like for me. So
you haven't had to buy any products. You haven't been shopping in Hermes.
Oh, I do. I do shop there as much as possible. It's great. I love Hermes. They're the best. They're the NASA of fashion. I mean, I think I was disappointed by Margiela's collection because it wasn't that freaky. And I also, mainly because I couldn't wear any of it, it was too, like, it made me look too gay. Not that I've got any problems being gay, but, like, I have to defend my heterosexuality in this business a lot. And so, like, I couldn't work the Margiela thing, which is a bummer, because that was a cool combination. And this is called Uncle Tom's Kitchen Set. And it's kind of, like, three different brands of American racist packaging. Full scale.
You'll have to remind us what they're like, because we don't have them.
Oh, you don't have, right, of course. Well, in America, there was this thing called slavery. And it's the defining thing. It's the thing that defines America, the African diaspora. I mean, in art, the only real art that we have, you know, we've got abstraction and we've got jazz. And jazz comes from Africa. And these packaging, you've got cream of wheat, Aunt Jemima complete, and Uncle Ben's. And the idea here is, like, you'd have these slaves cooking these awesome meals because they're great cooks, because they're resourceful, because they were slaves and they had to do the best they could. So you had these amazing chefs making this great food. So you the advertising concept here is you associate, like, this, you know, this black guy with a tie bringing you your cream of wheat in bed in your plantation, and, you know, Aunt Jemima bring you pancakes, and they're the best because she did it with love, because she's a house Negro. If you know Malcolm X's speech about the field Negro and the house Negro, like, the field I'm not gonna go totally into the field Negro is the guy who wanted to take over and, like, kill the white guy, and the house Negro had a sweeter deal because he didn't work in the fields, he worked in the house, so you got to sleep in a nicer place and eat better food, eat the scraps or whatever. So this is kind of about that, and that's what art great American country is built on. This is called Hermes Reject Box, and these are all rejected plungers. I was making a model of a plunger out of Hermes packaging, and a toilet plunger, you know, and they didn't, none of these really worked out. Like, the first one, the shape was wrong, and the second one was the same shape, and then the third one was too messy, and then the fourth one was neat, but it started to look like Buckminster Fuller's Dymaxion house. And then, so I made the Dymaxion house, and then that started to look like a hamburger, and then I was like, ah. So I was gonna, and then I made all the hamburgers, and that's what that came from. But this shape, the outside, is a dub version, or even a morph version of this bulletproof testing chamber that I'll show you a picture of in a few minutes, but if you can remember that shape. And Timothy, this is called Oklahoma City Bombing Kit, and Timothy McVeigh rented this truck inside. That's the truck that he rented. It's a small model. It's the largest truck you can rent, and he filled it with fertilizer and motor oil and made a two-part super powerful explosive and blew up this civic building, killed a lot of people. So that's kind of like the kit that you need to do that. So I wish it was this size in real life, but this is the smallest model of the smallest Mondrian that I could find. and it's in the Museum of Modern Art. And this is a exact model in every sense, the frame. I tried to make the cracked surface because he didn't really know what he was doing with technical stuff, so like all his paintings are falling apart. And so it's like an exact model of a Mondrian, sort of the way the hamburger meals with a model of the hamburger meals. But these are all done with gaffer's tape.
And these are standard colors?
Well, yeah, these are all regular gaffer's tape colors. And they're pretty close. I mean, I go to the museum and check it out and measure them and take a look at the color samples and match them. This one was really hard because that's all different colors of tape. And there are two versions of this that I made, one with standard gray and one with cheating gray, which is white tape painted to be gray because the gray wasn't really, really wasn't close enough. So I had to work that idea out both. And the one with the standard gray is better.
What about the way these will age? I mean, these will start weeping soon.
Yeah, the only thing that I don't really like is when they yellow within the first 16 months, which has happened a couple times because I got a bad batch. So I recalled all those and redid them. But the idea is, like, if we go back to the first one, which is really weathered, like the sides of the tape are a different color. And that's right, because the Mondrians are like that. And they're like that for a bunch of reasons. One, because he used tape, and one, because he didn't know what he was doing. But the idea of decay and falling apart is interesting, because then it gives it a history, and it makes it more like the original Mondrian. And only the third reason is that he really mocked his paintings out. You can really see it here in strips of tape. And in this show at Ropac, there's this one here that's New York City 3 unfinished. And it's got, this one is made with just pieces of tape stuck on a canvas, and so is mine. It's even got a thumbtacks. So there's the tape is the continuity here, really. Pendaba Brillo, and Pendaba's a Japanese merchandising character. She's a friend of Hello Kitty's. Does everyone know who Hello Kitty is? Hello Kitty's a character, like a little, let me get my bag, and I'll show you what she is. She's pure license. She's got no TV show or book like Mickey Mouse or anything, or no history. She was born in 1976, and her PR line is that she lives in a London suburb, but she's like this kitty. See? And here she is wearing her Silence of the Lambs bearskin outfit. And see, that's really what she looks like. That's her there. Oh, anyway, but the interesting thing about her is that she gets kids into shopping at an early age, and she has no mouth, which makes her feminine, according to the president of Sanrio. So there's this whole politically incorrect quality that makes her attractive to me. And there's like, I think her sculpturing is good. Some of her friends, like Kuropi, I really don't like, because the way they're drawn isn't balanced, or I don't know, it isn't appealing. But Pendaba's great, even though she has a liver infection. So what's happened here is on the left are all things that I bought, and like Brillo and my phone and a little, I don't know what that is, like a puff case or something, and playing cards and a keychain. And then on the right are the dub versions of them. So although I've removed it one step just by making it, and also because it's not original, in a way the originals become the prototype for the final version. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And then you'll see.
Are all these things bought in the States?
Yeah, they're Japanese, and I buy them wherever I go. You can find them in London. It's not hard to find, but it's mostly. And this is my whole Hello Kitty collection, built in dub style. And I'll show you closer. It's called Super Dynamite Soul, and you know, I know there's some artists out there and some architects too, and you know, you start on a project and you're like, I'm just gonna do this thing, all right? So it starts with a simple idea, like make my whole Hello Kitty collection out of foam core, and then you do one and you're like, God, that took 5 hours. And then you do another one, and you're like, that one took 2 days. And then sooner, you know, it takes forever. And you can see that these things are all the way around, so that you're only seeing 1/6 of the whole piece. The boxes are foam core with Lexan doors, Scotch tape hinges, and gaffer's tape and Velcro latches, so that you can take it all out.
That's much less like a product than a lot of the things you've shown so far. Is that, could somebody buy that?
Yeah, someone could buy. Someone did buy it.
But how did you feel about it going?
Relieved. Because you know, David Ross told me, people in California dream about sex, and people in New York dream about storage. So, storage is a huge, huge problem, and you know, I just make whatever I want, and I'm like relieved if someone takes care of it.
Is that David Ross, the painter?
No, the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art director. But this is, in a way, this is its own shape. And it's derived from me and not the from something else. And in a way, we're talking about creativity is the enemy. And I think that's the title of this thing.
It's your title.
What's that?
It's your title.
Yeah, and I'll tell you why. And it's because this shape here isn't anything. It's just a tower. But it's important to, you know, it's kind of like ornament and crime. You know, Luce, it's important to just keep it simple. Bottom line, you know, it's like once you start being creative and adding your own thing to it, then it's ruined and it's sullied. But if you can just keep it stripped of everything and not be, like Duchamp said, a mediumistic, but just always to keep it as conservative as possible, then radical ideas can shine and be available to the viewer or whomever.
Is the table? What about the table?
Oh yeah.
I'm sorry. The base.
Well, the table is foam core, but I have to admit I weaseled out and went to Knoll, dropped money and bought the base. It's a, you know, it's a Saarinen base, and I was gonna do a whole Knoll Saarinen top, but they didn't have the right one in stock, so it's like a mismatched. And also, it's impossible in foam core, and it almost had to be metal. So, on the left is a dub version, and on the right, it's like the real thing or whatever, although I wouldn't say the dub thing is any less real, just the way Gucci sunglasses bought on the street are just as real as the ones you buy in the store. They're just not licensed. But the thing on the right is a 12-gauge shotgun just like this, and it's made of plumbing and springs and wood from like Con Edison wood, which Con Edison's the power company in New York, and it's a sort of stolen wood that's been filed down to fit into a gun shape. And I'm gonna pass this around. It's a 12-gauge shotgun, it's real, okay? So don't point at anyone's face. Even though it's empty, I'm gonna show you all that it's empty. So I'm gonna pass a real shotgun that I smuggled through the airport security. All right, you can see light through it, okay? All it's real. Don't point it at anyone. Just to be dogmatic with guns. And, I'll just give this back to you.
Very nice to wait so long to see electrotheatre. I mean, I feel I should be in a sequin dress. I'm now going to pass it to the audience.
What happened here? It's very important that the last person at the back sends it up to me, because it's an exhibit. And then it's 4 hours
of 7. Thank you. Sure, so you can, you know. You should grab it by the handle too. You should feel like, because it's, you know. It does? Good. That means you're an advanced man. So, anyway, this piece is called A Life in the Arts, and it's about Chet Baker. It's actually an essay that I read by Dave Hickey called A Life in the Arts, and his thesis in it was that jazz critics hated Chet Baker because he wouldn't suck. He wouldn't innovate after a certain point. He just played beautifully, and he had a wonderful life in the arts. And there's some shady stuff going on with his death and drugs and stuff, but the idea that he just played, and that was his thing, was to play and create a life for himself and not be a Miles Davis, you know, not be historically important. That he just played and beautifully. Because I think, and in a way, this is like the closest thing to an art world response, because the art world wants to build you up and take you down. And in a way, all we really want as artists is time to make things. And architects, we just want to be able to work. And the success system doesn't have anything to do with that, whether you're Chet Baker or you or me or anybody. I just kind of figured it out, you know. I just like there are some military manuals, like survival behind enemy lines, bricolage things that are really interesting, that are available on the internet, that you should definitely look at. But in the end, after reading like all 20 of these books, the things that you'd think up yourself are just as good as these manuals overwritten for an 8-year-old. But the idea first came about because in New York they have this thing to get guns off the street. They'll give you $75 if you bring your gun and hand it in the police station. And so I made a gun and brought it in and got $75 and went out and bought a cheap gun so that I could have a gun. And I thought that was pretty like crazy that it could happen. And then you know, but then I like the one that I made better, so I started making more of them. And they're more than $75 now, unfortunately. So that's the other view of that one.
And these, you have fired them?
Yeah, I've fired them, and I'll show you the testing chamber sort of at the end. And this is called Pleasure Chest, and it's a cabinet with guns that I made with Dirk Westfall, my friend. It's, you know, it's kind of scary to do all this stuff by yourself, so we got together and did this one. And this one's like just all 12-gauge shotguns. That wood is sort of those barrier woods. You see them here in the street. But we have it in wood here instead of plastic. We have plastic ones here.
That's police or Con Ed?
This is Con Ed. Police is coming up. This is in Paris. If you go see that show, it's in the back. You gotta ask to see it. The inside of it. This is called Deluxe Dueling Set. Inside of a different one, similar. Mm-hmm. Police line do not cross. Barriers also stolen. Chopped up. Inside, you've got 2 9mm single shot, laser sighted pistols. And they just have those laser pointers that I wish I had right now to point out some of the details for you. Has anyone got a laser? Is there a laser in the house? Excellent. Oh, great. Thanks. Excellent. All right. So this is the gun. And you load, let's look on the bottom one there. You load one of these cartridges in here. And then you take one of these plugs and you screw it on the back. And then you cock the hammer and you pull the trigger. You push it up like that and it flies forward and makes a little explosion and the bullet goes out the front. In here you've got everything you need. You've got these ramrod screwdrivers to sort of clear it out. You've got the Sharpie to record how many times it's been shot. Tape and crazy glue for repairs. You got the log book or scorecard for writing notes when all this happened. Spare springs and a clock to sort of, you know, give you some time. Like in Barry Lyndon, you know, when he shot his stepfather in the leg and he's hesitating, he just had a clock to think about it. It could have all been avoided. And vice grip and hammer and file. I like the view of that. It's cool. Condensed. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Can you hear at the back?
I'll repeat it.
Even this has its own aesthetics. It doesn't have green or purple. It has a particular choice of material.
Right. Well, that's right. I mean, I tried to use the... Okay, the question is, we're talking about creativity as the enemy, and the way I understand the question is, this doesn't have colors like green or purple, it's...
Yeah.
I'm questioning the use of the word creative and suggesting perhaps it should have been aesthetic, because with the kitty piece, I could see that you were going against contemporary trends in aesthetics, but you were still creating. This is very creative, and it's aesthetic. It has, and I'm sorry to pose this now, but as your title of
that's
the talk
fine.
Is about, and I mean, it is an artwork. You can't run away from.
Oh, I know, and yeah. It's a totally contradictory statement coming from me, and it's, yeah. I mean, you know, you have to listen more in the Dada part of the art history lesson, but I mean, not to diss you at all, I just mean that if you can try and be as uncreative as possible, and remove it as much as possible, and use the material, the color of the material as the way it is, like, steel should be rusty, and foam core should be white, and stolen police line should be...
But you didn't do that with Kitty. Kitty became sort of pure white, like when people copied the classic.
I know. Sweet. I know, that's true, and I feel so lucky that foam core comes in white, because it just suits her, because she's so lily white and
so
pristine.
So would you say that you're sticking to this, what occurred in the 80s a lot, which was when artists just took given materials and carried them through as their material?
I don't know about that. I don't know about that movement.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not sure exactly what you're referring to.
Well,
but,
you're standing next to one, and quite a lot of the British 80s
artists. Oh, yeah, like that. Yeah. Yeah, totally.
And you had a few in America, too.
Yeah, no, like this guy. It is what it is. It's been changed, but it's still it. You know, it's still a ladder, and it's still a galvanized bucket, even if it's, like, humping another one or something. It's, like, it's still it, yeah.
I think we should talk about this later.
So this is what a 12-gauge shotgun, like the one that you're holding, is someone holding it still? Has it left the building?
Who's got it?
All right. So
good. Yeah, no, we know where it's got to. It's nice.
Is this fun? I've missed this. Okay. This is what a 12-gauge shotgun does to 2001: A Space Odyssey.
Are you Jewish, Tom?
Sort of by birth, but I mean.
I thought that's how it came.
It is. It's my heritage, and I'm cut. But you know, I'm more of like pagan.
So am I. But I'm not Jewish.
Well, I am, you know, definitely more Jewish since I moved back to New York City. I was kind of in denial when I was here. You know, contact lenses, short hair. Well, it fires 12-gauge shotgun cartridges, so anything you can load into a 12-gauge shotgun, it'll shoot. Yeah, this is actually the previous one. Well, actually, I mean, without getting too like technological, it's this load was dove and quail load. It's so specific. There are hundreds of different types of load. And I use dove and quail because they're cheap. And because they have a good spread, like buckshot, the holes, buckshot only has like, I don't know, a dozen double-aught balls, like the size of a, I don't know, a bicycle bottom bracket bearing. And dove and quail has like over 100 little tiny ones, so it makes a better spread. And I've experimented with all those things, and for shooting books and paintings, dove and quail is perfect. For example, this is a Ross Bleckner that I shot. I had to shoot it twice, though, because it first didn't look right the first time.
So that's a Ross Bleckner painting?
Yeah.
That he gave you, or you stole? Or?
It's a painting that I have that I shot that he made.
He gave you.
Okay, sure. Yeah, it's that whole Rauschenberg de Kooning trip. But it's about this big. It's a small one.
Have you exhibited it?
Yeah, it's in Paris right now.
Microphone, can we just...
Maybe this is passed around. When it reaches you, you suddenly want to ask a question.
I can't help, as I'm listening to you, to think of the 80s and the art world in New York a lot, for a variety of reasons. But this one in particular reminds me of the Erased de Kooning.
Right. Well,
I thought maybe you might want to talk a little about that.
Sure. The 80s were interesting. I was here for a year, one-tenth of the 80s, and the rest of the time I was in Vermont and in New York and in Connecticut. So I kind of witnessed that whole thing, and for the first time, it was like I didn't have to be a doctor or a lawyer. I could have a Mercedes and be an artist. Not that I have one yet, but... You know, we're working on it. That's what, to go back to your earlier question about how many people do you have working for you, not enough for Mercedes is the answer. But, you know, there was definitely like an attraction, repulsion to that whole thing. I mean, Soho was happening, it was exciting. People were working, people were spending a lot of money on art. There was a lot of new stuff was going on. You know, the whole Saatchi thing was being built up and all that. But there was something really awful about it at the same time, because you just saw this thing turn into a business. And we're going to talk about that Chet Baker piece before with the two shotguns leaning like that. The dub one and the real one, A Life in the Arts. And I was talking about how they want to build you up and take you down. Remember? Yeah. It's kind of like anti-art. I mean, these things become companies. Like Ross is like, he's trying to be an artist, but he's a much bigger entity than one person. It isn't a question of having a lot of studio people, but about being a person. And that's why Andy Warhol, who is the ultimate art business machine, had no life, had no personality to him. And I think that it's a big struggle to find a balance. And this, you know, for me, shooting a Ross Bleckner was kind of like, I don't know, a catharsis or something. I mean, there is the whole, you know, when Rauschenberg got a de Kooning and erased it, there was like a reference to that, which is like this affectionate kind of like annihilation of an idea.
But in the 90s, there were a lot of artists who were doing critiques of the 80s. Yeah. They were looking at, you know, the way objects function in the marketplace and trying to make work that was a critique of the whole institutionalization of the art world.
Right.
However, what's interesting about this, what makes it different, is that you've appropriated the 80s. A lot of strategies of artists, the people like Steinbeck, for example.
Right.
And in order to critique that particular moment, and at the same time, I get the sense that you have a very ambivalent relationship to it. That is to say, as you want to buy the Mercedes, you'd like, half of you would like to be part of it.
Well, that's a really good point, actually, because I have ambivalence towards this and also towards fashion. And I think ambivalence is very important, because if it's just saying the 80s sucked, aren't we glad we're done with it, or critiquing it, then it becomes, in a way, propaganda, because art is... propaganda is art with a political message or with a politic. And I think it's more interesting and more open when there's some ambivalence that's obvious, where the idea creativity is the enemy or whatever is contradictory. Because once it's contradictory, you realize that it's not a dogma that I'm trying to shove down your throat, like some great artists like Hans Hacke, who are just like, this is about German, fucked up, Jewish stuff. You know, it's more interesting when it's when it's wrong, when the artist or the message is fallible. Is that... Because otherwise, it's, you know, it's propaganda and it's too easy. Because, you know, I love and hate Ross Bleckner's work. It's not simple, and thank God, it's not like some artists, like, you know, Leroy Neiman, that I just hate. He's, by the way, like the richest artist on the planet or something like that. Jasper Johns is number two.
Did you shoot this alone? Were you alone?
No, I think my friend Andrew Cromwell was there.
But was it I'm sort of getting...
Yeah.
I'm curious to know how ritualistic it was to do it.
Well, I mean, I wish it was better, like... Oh, this is my big moment with a real Ross Bleckner and a shotgun. But it was like, it was actually outside in a field. And normally I shoot them in a testing chamber. This one I want to hand do it. And it was like the sun was coming down and the Klansmen from the shooting range that we go to in Connecticut were like, come on boys, time to go home. And I was like, come on, just two more. And so we just kind of did it and threw in the truck and we're out of there. That was like the reality of the situation. But, I would have loved to have, like, you know, loaded the shotgun shell up with, you know, $100 bills and, but, yeah.
But maybe that's almost an answer to Lisa's question. I mean, what I like about that is the kind of, you know, you've got 5 minutes and you better do it. And it's like, and that's what they all feel like when you look at them. They all look like you're running out of glue and, you know. It feels like the world.
Well, I didn't really think of that, but that's really, thank you for sharing that. And this might get really boring because we're going to talk about art process now.
Look, show another picture and then people will...
I'm sorry? Could I shoot him? Oh, someone should at this point. He needs a little sparking up, that guy. He's such
a
great artist.
Chris Burden is an artist who's about to have a show at the Tate and who shot himself, so this is an incredibly circular joke.
But he's a great artist, and you should totally go. He's one of the most influential artists to me and my whole generation. But to go back to Jane's question originally, I think the idea is you get into this trance when you're working, and you know it's going right, like when you're... I feel like I'm Michael Jordan when the hot glue gun's been plugged in for 8 hours, and it's only after like the fifth or sixth hour that I'm fully Jordan and I'm in my zone, and anything I touch is gonna look good and just gonna turn out right, like this phone book taped up just right. Sometimes they don't look so good, and those are the ones that have to get thrown out. But you get into this like shamanistic way where you just, the decisions you make, you know they're gonna be right, and sometimes... Like me, as someone who makes stuff, and we're all creative people, whether we're lawyers or artists, I've got a 75% success rate, self-judge on my work, and I think that's really, really high. Because I remember when it was when it was down around 10%. You know, like, no, seriously, when you think about it, like, when you're a student, you just come out of school or whatever, and you're working, and you can't get anyone to come to your studio, and you work, and you do your thing, and then all of a sudden, you have to move, or your lease is over, or you get evicted, or whatever, and you throw everything that you can fit into your truck, and it's just that stuff, and everything gets left behind, and that, whatever fit in that truck was the 10% that was success, because you cared enough to take it with you to your next place. So 75 is high. And the thing with the Ross Bleckner was, it was like we had to do it then and move on. That's why it turned out that way.
Keep running.
Keep running.
This
is the testing chamber and laser. You take the shotgun or pistol, whatever, and you strap it in there. And then you tie a string around it, and you lead it through a hole in this bulletproof glass out to here, and you put your telephone book or television or Ross Bleckner or whatever in there. And then you pull the string, and the bullet goes down the chamber. And there's supposed to be a Harold Edgerton viewing port there, but I ran out of time. And
could you explain who Harold Edgerton is?
Yeah, he's this guy who invented like stop-motion photography. He was in the Navy and took airplanes, photos out of airplanes, like surveillance photos, and invented these giant, he invented the strobe. So every time you take a flash picture, you owe him something. And he stopped the action of a horse, and he, you know, like, well, like,
he's
sort of like Moy Bridge.
He's the apple on the bullet, isn't he?
Yeah, that's it. The apple, exactly, or the milk drop.
Yeah.
So
you've seen it on the screen before, the apple and the bullet. And sure. The milk drop.
Sure. All right, so that's that. And behind it are some Knoll furniture.
What is the bucket to do?
It's sand.
In case
of fire. But actually, to be honest, that isn't there anymore. Because it felt like it was right. I took sand from the beach near the closest to where I grew up as a way of like a personal gesture of bringing it in, because I wanted to. It just seemed like things could go wrong, and it's always good to have a bucket of sand around.
Is David Smith lurking in those wheels?
Well,
David Smith is, for those of you who might not know, I suspect you all do know, was described by Oldenburg as the beginning of I think he called him an American inventor artist. And he's sort of on that moment when America finally stops having anything much to do with Europe and gets on and becomes America. And he used to put wheels on lots of things, didn't he?
Yeah, American, Kleisselberg called American inventing?
Inventor artists. I think it's a really, I mean, I think you're another one.
Well, I feel very connected to his work. And I remember sitting in this theater watching a film about David Smith and Helen Frankenthaler and all those alcoholics who were up in Bennington, and they were talking about him traveling around Europe, and I really felt, that's when I really felt like I belonged in America, and I left shortly after that, because David Smith, you know, there's a lot of folklore around him, but the one thing that he did do that was interesting that relates to our conversation, one of many things, is that he would sacrifice a tool. Like, if he would be standing there with his thumb, he made, like, if you don't know, it's very like, it looks like constructivism, but always out of steel and with I-beams, and pretty much looks, it comes out of constructivism, formally. It became known as formalism, Clement Greenberg stuff. But he would be standing there holding a hammer up to, or a pair of tongs up to the sculpture as an element, and then if it felt right, he would just weld it in place. So a lot of his sculptures have tools in there that are in as marks. And all the material here was stolen from different places. Like, the tube was from a Con Ed piece of plumbing, a huge pipe, and then the base itself is from Mark DeSouvreau's studio in Long Island City. And just that big I-beam, and then the wheels are hot dog cart wheels that I got from the hot dog cart wheel store. There is the hot dog cart wheel store. And it's really bad, and I hate those wheels, but they do look like David Smith iron wheels. They're actually really cheap, bad ones, but
I mean, as a contributor, I mean, David Smith's come up by accident, but the thing I like about David Smith is that, and I think this speaks volumes for suffering from information, which we all do, is that he used to get a European art magazine, French art magazine called Cahiers d'Art, but he couldn't read French, so he just looked at the pictures. And if you look at early David Smith, you can see that's exactly what he did. Now, when I was a student, you'd be smacked for doing that. You know, it'd be something you'd be caught in the lavatories reading Art Forum, and you'd have to do a penance. But I think the strange thing for me to be here today is realizing that the entire audience spends their entire time wet-fingering their way through any magazine. And it's only occurred to me this evening that that was a predicament for David Smith. He thought perhaps he was reading the criticism, but actually he was looking at the pictures. And it seems it presses on this evening somehow. I mean, along with lots of other things.
That's interesting. So who cares if wallpaper is the enemy of art as long as it looks good?
That's a rhetorical question. I'm not answering it.
Quickly here, that in the corner is that Tiffany Glock that you saw before, so you can see that it is small. And these are full-scale, like 59 Knoll sofas that are made in New York telephone books and duct tape on steel bases. The painting called Arthur, and it's duct tape on plywood.
Arthur, as in?
Arthur Sachs, my father.
I just thought it might be Arthur Dove, as in.
No, but it's also kind of like, remember when Ringo had his uncle Arthur in, I think, was in Help? Or no, Hard Day's Night. Like, it was kind of a real Dada gesture that he had this uncle that he would bring out of the closet to show for no reason, and he kind of got put back in the closet. So anyway, that's what that's from. But it's this next one. Oops. Is a small, it's 2 feet square, and you can really kind of see the tape marks a little bit better. I'll skip ahead to a couple. Alpine Junior.
Do you have Nuke the Swiss? Is that Nuke the Swiss?
Yeah, that's Nuke the Swiss. Well, it's actually, no, it's a different one, but Nuke the Swiss looks almost just like this. The tape strokes are smaller, but it's red duct tape on plywood and then silver duct tape over the red, so if it deteriorates or is neglected or damaged, the red will come through. But it was also a way of making the tape stick better, because duct tape's this amazing thing, or any kind of self-adhesive tape. It's only been called, we only associate self-adhesive tape with tape in the 20th century. Before that, it was just any ribbon was a tape, or audio we call tape also. But self-adhesive tape's amazing because it'll stick to anything but itself. And an old, if you bake a roll of duct tape, it'll glue itself to itself if you add heat as a catalyst. Which, you don't need to do it because I did it, it's not that interesting. And it's got a steel frame, and there's a painting in Paris that looks very similar to this. Like, you probably won't remember that it's different, but it's called Nuke the Swiss.
Just ignoring the title, just want to say one little thing. Just ignoring the title for a minute, which I think we'll have to discuss. If you know all of that subject that would surround somebody like David Smith, or all of the discussion around abstract expressionism, where people put a lot of pressure on, say, my generation, for really to do with painterly qualities. People would talk about, and they would make this gesture, which I can still make. And I think everybody here knows what that means. But it's somehow it's never taste, which is very confusing for a student, because you don't quite know what it is, but it's something I suspect later Brian Hatton will explain it fluently. But it involves great tact. And seeing this on Saturday, I was terribly confused by it, because this is extraordinarily beautiful, and yet it's made with this rubbish that everyone is familiar with. So you're sort of, it's, I think, a very direct kind of contradiction for a whole lump of art history. And I can sort of hear I can't remember his name. I knew it would happen. I can hear people turning in their graves. Don't worry. I'll think of it later. Carry on.
Okay. Well, the monochrome's great because it's just because it looks great over a sofa, and that's important. Ad Reinhardt?
No, it wasn't. The one that lived in England. More of a Tashist.
Okay. So this is kind of the one that came before all of it. It's just shown here because it's called Falling.
Mark Toby.
Mark Toby, all right. He's good.
But he was fine. You see, in my mind, he's filed near Twombly, and I knew I didn't want to say Twombly. I wanted to say Toby. So I had to withdraw until I got a tip. Sorry, go on.
So this, I wanted to do a picture of the falling man, falling the slippery when wet, rather, is what that means. And I didn't really feel comfortable using paint because it, you know, it's messy and it's like too much like art. There's a lot of it. Obviously ambivalence about. So I made it in duct tape, which is something I do feel very comfortable and familiar with. But then the background is really what I found interesting, and you can see the strokes. So I kind of got rid of the imagery and went to that, just to do the little background. And you can see I lined it vertical stripes underneath. You can see the relief, which looks really bad. But this is still okay. Actually, this is upside down, unfortunately. I always get this confused. I'm loading it in this carousel. It's called 800, and that was a plane, a TWA flight number that has been since retired, kind of like you know, Babe Ruth's New York Yankees jersey. You can't fly an 800 on TWA anymore because all these people died. And so anyway, that's Hello Kitty flying. Oh, by the way, if anyone wants to leave, they should don't feel obliged, because I used to sit in the front row, so I couldn't really see, because I was wearing my contact lenses, remember? And I was sat next to Alvin, and I would get up in the middle if it was some boring guy, Russian guy talking about constructivism, and I'd just like leave, like making all this noise, and he would always like yell at me for doing that. So you should definitely leave, because I don't care.
Very risky. Can I know where the gun's got to, please? Can we have a show of... Okay, good.
You know that's not going to work. Someone will just, like, out. So this is also another 800 from that series. That's the right side up.
Tom wrote me copious letters about why the 800... it's Flight 800,
yeah.
Isn't it? Why Flight 800 had crashed. I think I've kept them all.
Oh, cool.
And they still don't know.
They know. They know. It was totally a Navy missile that shot it out of the sky by accident. But I mean, you can't kill how many 300 Americans in the Navy and get away. You know, you can't admit to it. It's too complicated with government spending and stuff. I don't really want to talk about that.
Okay. Next.
Okay, so this is Hello Kitty Nativity scene, which I received numerous death threats for making and displaying in a Barney's window. Barney's is a fancy department store, kind of like... Yeah, thank you. And there were 300 other artworks in there, and they displayed it as a charity thing. They were going to sell them, and all the money would go to some school, and the Catholic League complained, which is a really conservative, crazy group of freaks. I mean, no, there are people that complain about advertising condom use on billboards. They're really scary people. And you can see it's Hello Kitty as baby Jesus with Bart Simpson, the three Bart Simpsonses bearing gifts from Barney's. They've been to Hermes. This one's from Switzerland. And that, you can see that he's got the Barney's bag, and there's Madonna, and she's got her headset. You see, that's the headset, and her Chanel Air Jordan booties, which was the style at the time. And I think the problem really was the nipples, because in America we love a shotgun in the face, but we hate nipples. You know. I don't know why, but I think that was what pushed it over the edge. I thought it was something about animals and being representing Jesus and Mary, and animals are the agent of Satan and some of that stuff, but in the end, I think it was the nipples. So we're just about done here. This is the last piece, but I'll show you three slides of it. It's called the Sony Outsider, and it's, no, they didn't give me money or sue me. It's a full-scale model of the Fat Man, the atomic bomb that was dropped on Nagasaki 2 or 3 days after Little Boy was dropped on Hiroshima. And it's a full-scale model in every sense. It's got, you know, all the rivets and the antenna mounts and the detonator thing. And these are clamp covers. And as I did all this research, even though I just call it a detonator thing, to measure it, and I went, there are three of them in the United States, I went and measured all three of them and sort of made a composite, a best of the three, because they're all missing parts. And instead of doing a whole, like, bomb inside, which is so complicated and expensive, especially with uranium being so scarce, I thought it would be more interesting to make the inside sort of a Japanese capsule hotel. And inside it's all leather with Sobakawa pillows, those buckwheat husk pillows that are so comfortable, and leather walls, and a sink and vacuum toilet that's hooked up to a shop vac, and this blanket, which is like the same pattern as the airplane blanket, but expensively done in leather, with a zipper pouch for your sunglasses and condoms. And you can sort of see a different view of the DVD 6-channel Dolby discrete surround sound system, and the overhead lighting, and the secondary backup circuit board. Not the primary ones would be over here, but I don't have a photo of it. It's got in-out ventilation. It's a hatchback. It kind of opens and closes. I don't have to say about it. I mean, it was pretty slick, and I tried to make it as handmade as possible. And you don't see in real life that it's all held together with like caulking, and all the writing is done by hand. And it's a little bit messier than it looks, but I was trying to make it slick, and I just failed miserably. So it's a perfect success in the end. And that's, by the way, that's Ursula Andress as Honey Rider in Terence Young's, I think, 1964 Dr. No, which is the first James Bond movie.
So she's not moving around.
Well, it's actually what happens is this piece comes with a booklet, and the booklet has a number of digital video discs in it, you know, a dozen of films that I thought pertained to, which were in a way sort of the inspiration to the making of this piece, or not, but in a way it was, it's for the occupant, and it was in a way the project analysis, or the occupant is, or user, is a Japanese teenage schoolgirl whore. Is the ideal object that belongs in there, but or the ideal person, but then someone suggested that she should be part of the equipment, and you know, which makes it, it's, which is an interesting argument.
And is it sold?
Actually, right now it's going to be on display. This is a show about a year ago, and it's going to site Santa Fe in New Mexico, where which is kind of like an American Kunsthalle, and it's very close to where the bomb was built in Los Alamos. So there's like a continuity. It's not sold yet. It's sort of on a traveling thing. For sale. And then finally, sideways. This is the only slide that's wrong in the whole batch. And it's
what do we do?
It's kind of, no, just look at it sideways. It's good. It's a it's just a close-up of Hello Kitty and my glue gun. Close-up of my favorite.
Is that a sort of sanitized? I imagine the work. I don't know what your workshop looks like.
Oh yeah, my workshop's really big and messy and filled with junk. And this is just like a close-up of the table of just Hello Kitty model. So I think that's the last slide. We could go back or...
Well, I think... Is the mic out there somewhere? If people would like to ask questions, and we'll do... Since I know that people have to go, so we'll do 10 minutes, and if they're incredibly interesting, we'll do 15. And then we'll... Does anyone have? I haven't rehearsed a question, so it's utterly important that you have one.
I have a really open question. Really, is where does morality fit into your work? Kind of
right.
10 minutes.
Okay. No, really quickly, I'll tell you. I'm on this council for the New York Foundation for the Arts, which is like this big grant-giving council, and one of their projects is sending out a newsletter to high schools in New York State and the tri-state area on teaching design in school. So they asked me, they said, okay, we're going to ask, there are all these different people in this panel, we're going to ask an artist what kids should know about design. So I went in there and I was like, well, I think that they wanted to know, like, should they look at Italian design or what? And I said, well, if you want to look good, just look at the Italians, but the most important thing is planned obsolescence, that kids should know about what planned obsolescence is in school, because they're going to get out of school when they're 23 and they're going to need a job and they're going to do whatever the fuck they can just to feed themselves. And planned obsolescence is this thing that isn't even mentioned in any issue of Consumer Reports. It's not part of... No consumer advocacy group has conquered this incredibly corrupt part of industrial culture and or consumer culture, whatever it is. And so that's kind of... To me, that's the real enemy, is planned obsolescence. And nowhere on this panel was ethics brought up, because you asked me the question, ethics. Nowhere on this panel was ethics brought up. It was just a question of like looks and technique and learning. So I feel like I'm ethically minded, but you know, I love shopping at Hermes too. So it's, I hope that kind of informs, answers some of it. Is that what you were thinking, or?
I was just wondering, because I suppose there are lots of references that you've made that would be seen to be contentious. Classic kind of controversial statements, bringing together the maliciousness of fashion with very profound things like bombs or things that I mean, the camp, I suppose, is about the most severe contrast between form and content in that respect. I'm wondering what decision you would make in not doing something. What would stop you saying, no, I couldn't do it? Like the classic comic line, like, can I really make a joke about this?
Oh, I don't believe that. I think the more taboo, the better. And not to be professionally provocative, but because it makes you think. I mean, I wouldn't want to be a provocateur, but it would be worse to be a propagandist, to have a political view to say death camps are bad, or nuclear bombs are bad, or excessive fashion and clubbing seals is bad. I want you to decide that for yourself. As, you know, and I also think that everything is subjective. So just because I made it doesn't mean my opinion of it is better or worse than yours. I mean. I do it all the time. I mean, I think if something... I'll keep on working on something until it gets pulled out of the studio. And if it comes back from a show where there were like 100 pieces of the show, and it came back because it didn't sell, it'll get recycled into something else. Like, I think recycling is an important part of the process, because you learn what works and what doesn't work. And there's things out there that didn't work perfectly, but they're out of my control right now. But that's part of just working. And, yeah, I mean, I do recycle them. So, like that big Hello Kitty shrine, if someone didn't give me a whole bunch of money for that, I probably would have made it into like 8 other pieces.
So. Would that have meant 8 Saran tables?
I don't know, I didn't really think about it because I didn't get that far. I got cut off before I could, before commercialism's evil claw came into the creative process and stopped it halfway. Yeah.
How much have you upset anybody this connects to?
Yeah, well, I think the Hello Kitty thing so far has been the most controversial. Not that anyone was really upset, but I think this particular group decided that they were going to be upset about it, because I got 150 hate mail letters, and I read them all, and they're all pretty much the same letter, so it leads me to believe they had a letter writing campaign. There were 2 or 3 in there that were true psychopaths, so. But then again, I don't think it's me or the work, I think it's the situation. I mean, I don't think that any one of those people confronted of this work individually for a week would have been upset as much as being rallied by their leader. I mean, it was the whole mob rule thing. It was like this conservative religious fanaticism. I mean, I've seen much worse than that, you know, and on primetime TV. You know, The Simpsons is much more sacrilegious than my show.
Beautiful slip. Tell everybody what the key does.
All right, so the key is for the guillotine, and should I show that? This is a picture of the Chanel guillotine that
she
Richard
can pass.
Was describing. So, this is the Chanel guillotine. You pass that around here. And, there are two. It's a real thing, you know, just like the guns. It's 3 meters high or so, and it's got a razor sharp blade that weighs 80 pounds with the wheels and falls with 22,000 foot pounds of force at the moment of impact, or some crazy number like that. So it'll definitely cut a real head off, and. It has 2 keys, sort of like a nuclear fail-safe system. So I have one, and Tadeusz Ropak, the art dealer, has another one. So we both have to be in the same place at the same time to make it do its thing. And some of those gun cabinets that I show you also have 3 or 2 keys.
Since the catalog's going around, do you think the catalog might be a mistake?
There are a couple of pictures in there that I think should have been turned the wrong way around. And,
never happens here. I mean, how much could you... This is really a question for people who try and control these things. I mean, to what extent...
Well,
I mean, you control the language of the work,
yeah.
And then the catalogue, which is tells you quite a lot. If you've not seen the show, the catalogue will tell you quite a lot. But the catalogue is definitely in the language of catalogues.
Right. Well, it relates to the question about the... about the press and the Hello Kitty Nativity scene. It's kind of the same thing. It's like I do my thing in my little own world in the studio, and then someone overlays the filter of an art world catalog onto it, and all of a sudden it's cleaned up. They, you know, they frost out all they sanitize it and desensitize some of like the finer points. But I think that's okay because that's a commercial. I call that a brochure. You know, I mean,
it's French. I
yeah, because it's for sales, and like I'm aware of that, and I don't have any problem with that. That's their business. But my thing is about making stuff, and sure, it's a problem. But listen, you know, I've scrubbed toilets for a living. If like that's the worst compromise I have to come up with, fine. I do know, though, in front of an audience, that I wish they had put the death camp in there, and I think they chickened out because my dealer is Austrian. And there are people in Paris that don't like, that like Jews that would buy art that don't because he's Austrian. So I think that's why he didn't use it.
Did you confront him?
No, because I was so busy. I didn't even notice till yesterday I was in there. I will.
been asking this question about art ever since about conceptual art. It's about the nature of a continuity of practice. Like, you see people who do good things, and then they do another good thing, and another good thing. And I'm thinking, well, how does the next thing happen? What is your idea of your continuity? Because with painters, you know, it's going to be another painting, more or less.
Right. Well, like David Smith said in that film that I saw in this theater, I'm thinking about three things. The things that I'm working on now, things that I just finished, and the things that I want to make. So a lot of it comes out of consumer lust. Like, I really wanted a chainsaw. So I was like, okay, I'll just make one. And into my process of making one includes buying one so that I can make a model of it. And same with my Glock, and I already have the toilet, and, you know, whatever it is. So I'm driven by lust, you know, sexually and commercially. And TV is always a great backup. Like, you know, if you're just so lame, you can't get it up in one way or another, TV's always there. It's like mother, lover, you know, teacher, it's all there. Secret lover, maybe. But, you know, that's like a kind of a mystical thing. But the part that I could share is just that it's my own. And it comes from me and not from anybody else. I mean, although you see things in here, obviously, that are derivative or referential to other things, those are things that I want, you know, like I wanted a Ross Bleckner, I want a Brancusi, you know, and I want that form in my life some way, so it was very easy to make it with the
book. And Andy Warhol said pop art is liking things.
Yeah.
Can you repeat that?
Andy Warhol said pop art is liking things.
I mean, it's simple, but it's really right. It's not a big, mystical, pretentious thing. It's like a simple, kind little thing.
I have to ask one more question, and then if there's another one, we can have it, but then we won't have any more if there isn't another one. In the show in Paris, I don't know where it is, but somewhere written on the edge of a picture, or, I mean, Mondrian is acknowledged, but you mentioned H.C. Westerman.
Yeah.
And, I mean, you actually name him. I mean, I can name, I think there's been a kind of naming game of cousins and relations in present art and in art history. And we all have those anyway. But it's quite a thing to actually... H.C. Westerman, maybe Tom of all people should describe who H.C. Westerman is, because he's not that well known. But I'm curious to know why he got a leg up into Sachs' world.
Wow, well that says a lot. Well, H.C. Westerman is an American artist, he's dead. He was a great carpenter, he was in the Navy, he was in a shipwreck, everyone died except for him and a couple other guys, and they all got eaten by sharks and he witnessed it, and he was a circus performer and he had this amazing life, and there probably aren't more than three or four people in this room of super overeducated people who know who he is. But 10, you think? Yeah. Okay, let's have hands. H.C. Westerman? One,
fake
two.
Fake it.
Neil? Where's your hand? Let me see it. Three.
We got one over here.
Four,
we got
five.
Up to four.
Okay, so we're six.
Anyway, worth finding out about.
He's a bricoleur, was the main thing, and that was a word that I learned in this room from Richard that I didn't know before, bricolage, which is kind of like handyman, do-it-yourselfer, but it's also, it's French, so it's kind of like the difference between brie and Velveeta. You know, it's like, and cheese is the real reference there.
I never said that.
No, I'm adding onto you. But so Westerman's cool because he did bricolage and he was into craftsmanship. And he said, see America first. And he was very pro-American. And so am I.
I see no hands.
So
I don't want to say another word. I think it's a perfect. It's on film too. Tom Sachs, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.